The program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to a sunny and sweltering South Africa. We're in the middle of the bush and there are some lounging lions behind me. This is Safari Live. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this, your live safari from the middle of the Kruger National Park. My name is James Hendry. Uthanda is on camera today, and out in the bushveld we have Stefan Winterboer scouring the logs into the holes for the smaller things of the bush, perhaps a few big things too. You've already met Brent Leo Smith. He's with the Nkuhuma Pride, famous pride. He'll tell you a bit about them going forward. And of course, Jamie Patterson, the ultimately elegant antelope, is out looking, hopefully, for Karula, the queen of Juma. Now, I'm going to dismount from this tree. It is a knobthorn tree, everybody, that was rendered dead by elephants. This might result in interesting television because I could easily fall from here. I'm of advanced years, as you can see, and not quite as sprightly as I used to be. Watch out, Eggsy, here I come. Oh! There we go. Now, come with me. We're going to go into the tent because I, of course, have the best office in all the world. I'm just helping Eggsy here. And this is my office, everyone. I hope you like it. I hope you approve of it. Eggsy, stop standing on your cable. I'm going to go in through the window today. Very nice. Now, what we have in here is a vast array of different things to help us explore the wilderness. First of all, from the little, this is a microscope that's going to show us some little things. We'll look at some bugs and perhaps some flowers and that sort of thing. Then over here, we're just going to have a quick look there. The rover. This is Ronald the Rover, everybody. He's a small robot-like thing. And if you look, oh, look, let's move him. Watch this. There is an elephant. Just having a drink. Ronald is a tiny little sort of, he's a robot. And he's sitting there at mongoose eye level. That's what he's doing there. So that's the other thing we have there. And then we also have a view of the dam camera, which we'll have a look at now. There we are. That's the dam camera, everyone. And Ronald is just the other side of that. We'll find him with the dam camera shortly. Now, Jamie Patterson is out scouring the landscape for the pug marks of the great queen. Let's go and find out how that search is going.
Good afternoon and welcome to the sunset safari, and no sign of the Queen of Juma, but the disappearing bottoms of a troop of baboons. Oh, what? The last time we saw baboons, of course, it was under much more tenuous circumstances, with the baboons chasing and scaring the cubs of a leopard that we were sitting with, known as a Tundi, who then disappeared off into the bushes, managed to save her two tiny little cubs and escape herself to the top of a tree. One of the most incredible interactions between leopards and baboons I have ever seen. My name is Jamie, and this afternoon Viam is on camera with me. Let's see if we can't try and catch up with the baboons a little bit further around the corner. Since the last time we saw them, we were a little bit distracted by all that was happening around us. Now, that particular sighting showed us two things. One, the extraordinary bravery of a female leopard in the defense of her... Oh, that's... You're not a baboon. You're not a baboon at all. You're an elephant. It's the joy of a live safari. You never know what to expect. Oh, well, let's go and have a look at the elephants then. I was going to say, that sighting taught us two things. One is the extraordinary bravery and also the clever approach that female leopards can adopt in saving their offspring. And the other was that this particular troop of baboons, and it is the same troop, has one tiny, tiny little baby with it. I'm hoping at some point they might settle down enough for us to get a view. But for now, we've got this lovely young bull, who I think is a little bit shy. Oh. I don't know where to look now. There's baboons on my right and elephants to my left, and neither of them have particularly good views. Live wildlife filming. Can you see that one in the tree there, Vian? In the gwari bushes. There we go. It's just because we hardly ever get to see baboons, I thought it might be really nice to spend a little bit of time watching them before we move on to the amazing elephants. Oh, that was an interestingly timed jump, especially since that branch didn't really seem to want to hold that particular baboon's weight. Yes, we see you. You're hiding very well, but we still see you. Oh, they're playing in the trees. Youngsters chasing each other around. Oh, I say it's the same troop. I'm relatively certain it is the same troop of baboons. I saw that big male. That was the one responsible for chasing Tundi up the tree. Whoopsie daisy! Sometimes things go wrong, even when you're as good at climbing as baboons are. I'm sure we could just ask Brent or James about those sort of ungraceful dismounts. While I search for a better view of either baboons or the elephants, I'm not sure which, let's head across to Steph so that he can say hello.
Good afternoon from the bushwalk. Exactly. My name's Stefan Winterboer and on camera today is Jandre, and we've been marching from the camp this afternoon. I must be honest with you, we're probably about 2 or 3 miles away from the camp, and why I've decided to come here, I couldn't really tell you, other than that the last couple of weeks I've been centered around Juma and Juma Lodge, and basically where we stay. We haven't been moving much past the 2 mile mark, and today I thought we're gonna hit it out past the 2 mile mark and see what's happening in this part of the reserve from an on foot perspective. Of course, we get to go with these puppies where no one else can go, not a vehicle, no one can go. It makes it so special for us out here. And I don't really have a plan. What we've done is we've walked the wind into our face. We've walked into an area that I haven't been in for the last couple of weeks, at least on foot. And I don't know what to expect. There's been a bit of rain. There's a lot of pans in this particular area that have water reserved in them and have water contained in them, and obviously that draws animals from all over the place, most notably buffalo, which we've already walked in today. One skinny old buffalo that was a shame. I don't quite know if he'd even realized we were there. And of course there's always the ever-present elephant, lion, leopard, hippo and rhinoceros populations that are all over this place that we need to keep our ears and eyes open for. We're going to be going into the sand of the river here in front of us. And it's always a good idea when you're approaching a riverbed like this to stop, look, and listen. Why that is because animals like to spend the day in these shady drainage lines. This is a drainage line that you see in front of us. It drains an area of water. It's basically like a big creek, I suppose, or a little mini riverbed. And the trees here are relatively to the rest of the bush, quite leafy, and offer a lot of protection from both the sun and the wind that's been blowing incessantly today as well. So always a good idea, we stop, we look, and we listen. And that is probably my safety tip 101 out here in the African bush, here in the Kruger National Park. Most often it's your ears that give away whatever's in front of you. But Brent has been on the search for something special for you this afternoon, and I hear he's just found it. So see you later.
Well, with a pair of lions, as I said earlier, and we've got a big dominant male closest to us and a female behind. Now, my name is Brent Leo Smith. I have my good friend and fellow killer bee, Brian Joubert, and his thumb with us today. And we're quite sure the rest of the pride is somewhere in the shade just ahead. So at the moment, though we can only see two lions, there should be another male, another four females, and 8 cubs, so 15 in total. Now, lions are doing what lions do best at this time of the day, which is not much. As I said, it's a sweltering early summer's day here in South Africa in the Sabi Sands Game Reserve. About 90 degrees Fahrenheit, and you might notice that that male lion is carrying a wound. And that's probably from fighting over mating rights. And the reason he's lying so close to this female is because she is about to come into estrus, or is in early estrus. And he's making sure the other male who's around here somewhere doesn't get a chance to mate with her. So even though the four male lions that make up our dominant males in this area will battle other males together, when it comes to mating rights, they'll battle each other. Now that lioness has got a really interesting story, and in the fact that she's actually been mating with the Birmingham boys, our dominant coalition. This time last year, they were trying to kill her because she hadn't reached sexual maturity yet, and they actually managed and succeeded in killing two of her siblings. But she's managed to survive and make it through to adulthood, and hopefully she's going to be giving birth to her first litter of cubs in the next 6 months or so. Now, lion gestations normally only about 110 days, but quite often when a young lioness first sort of comes into her main estruses, she doesn't always immediately get pregnant. And sometimes even the 5th, 6th, 10th estrus she'll actually get pregnant. So these guys are going to snooze right here, so we know exactly where they are. They're not going to move. And I think just now I'm going to disappear into the little ravine there to see if I can find all the babies and the rest of the pride. Now, if we have a look at that big boy's nose, he's just lying at an awkward angle. Oh, there we go. Thank you. Colleen would like to know if I think that that wound is healing. I do, Colleen. The swelling has subsided drastically, and he is looking a lot more comfortable and not so much playing and fidgeting with it. As you can see, there are flies there. There we go. And I mean, there will still be discharge. There probably still is a bit of an infection, but not nearly as bad as it was a week ago. Now, male lions are constantly filled with holes, bites, scratches, limps, and it is tough at the top. That's generally why male lion coalitions don't last more than 5 years at the peak of at their prime. And there's a very important reason for this. If they sort of lasted longer than that, they'd end up mating with their own daughters. Even though in lion genetics, that's not such a big problem. They can mate or inbreed for up to about four, some people say 6 generations, without any adverse effects on the population. But if they keep doing it, it will definitely start influencing the population. Now, as we look down his back, you see, you always look carefully. You can probably see there's some, you know, some old scars that have healed up. There we go, there's one there. You can see some scratches. It looks like a bite up above. So they're constantly in the wars, quite often with each other around carcasses, often with the ladies who are not feeling their amorous attentions. And of course, most importantly, with any other males that might try come into this area to kick them out of this territory and take over their prides. Now, lions sleep for about 20 hours a day. They're very good at that, especially in this heat. And what I think we're going to do, because the one set of lions who might be active at this time of the day is the little cubs. So while we see if we can find a way down into the dry river system to see if the cubs are there and up and about, let's go to Jamie, who's got a great grey pachyderm.
Great pachyderms indeed, and as you can see, I have made my choice between the baboons and the elephants, and we have gone with the elephants largely because the baboons have disappeared, although the ellies seem to be thinking about doing exactly the same thing. I'm relatively certain that on an afternoon like this afternoon, it's hot, it's 32 degrees centigrade, so 90 Fahrenheit, really lovely and warm after the cold snap we've been experiencing. I'm thinking that they might want to go and have a drink. And from what I can see, usually you can see if elephants have just had a mud bath or a drink. They're usually a bit wet, a little bit covered in mud, since an elephant can't resist when it is next to water, throwing it over themselves. My suspicion is that they are slowly but surely making their way towards a waterhole, which would be lovely if we could have a chance to view the elephants like this little baby in front of you, out of the vegetation and a little bit more clearly. Okay, let's try and reposition again. We're in plenty of space. It's one of those gusting afternoons, which means that it's a little bit windy. Now, elephants are usually slightly more on edge when it is windy. They also tend to be slightly more on edge when it's hot, which is the combination that we have this afternoon. This would actually have been the perfect spot. An old off-road track from where Tingana had a kill many months ago, Tingana being the dominant male leopard of this area. I say would have, because the elephants have now... Oh, there's more of them. There's definitely more of them. I can hear those deep, low rumbles coming from the rest of the individuals in the herd. They must be just a little bit further ahead. It might even be worth investigating to see if some of them are out a little bit more in the open. And then we can really properly chat about the amazing nature of the elephants and the drought that they have survived so far, and a little bit more about their individual personalities and social structures. While we trundle along looking for a slightly better view of some elephants or whatever else we happen to come across, let's go and have a look at what James is looking at in the finest of detail.
In here, everyone, I have some dung beetles. Now, many of you will have heard of dung beetles, of course. There are up to 900 species of dung beetle around the world. What they are doing now, if you look in my hand, is that they are burrowing into what they perceive to be the surface of the soil. You can see the one on the right-hand side just burrowing down through my fingers, and the feeling is rather odd. It's rather otherworldly. It feels like there's an alien trying to dig into your flesh, which, well, it's not the best feeling in the world. Anyway, there are two or three different species of dung beetle here. Let's have a look at one under the microscope. Now, what you try and do with them is terrify them into sitting still. We will release these. None of these are permanent residents of the tent, everybody. Some of those things on the shelf are permanent residents, but that's because they are, in fact, dead. Well done. Good. Now, let's have a look here. I'm just going to focus in the microscope. And the colors on this little fellow are astounding. That, everybody, is called a bronze dung beetle. Now, I'm just going to fiddle with the light slightly. Look at that. Isn't that beautiful? It's called a bronze dung beetle. It's got a greenish sort of coppery head, like oxidized copper. And there you can see the head moving and the bronze wings underneath that. Isn't that gorgeous? Now, that thing, that bronze bit there, is called an elytra, everyone. And the elytra, if we have a look here, is... The elytra is the sort of shell, if you like. And on the those are not wings. Those are modified forewings. And underneath them are the wings that the dung beetle uses to fly. Now, let me just turn over quickly. There we are. You can see he's trying to crawl out from underneath me. Okay, hang on a second. Sorry about that. In fact, maybe... he's being a rather squiggly fellow. Anyway, I just wanted you to see underneath him. And mainly I wanted you to see underneath him because he's got mites on him. Now, mites, although they cause horrible things like mange... let me just see if I can't make him sit still briefly. There we are. I pinned him down. There we are. Now, there's his little feelers, looking very distressed. Of course, we will let him go, I promise. But underneath the hairs there, can you see those very fine hairs on him? Underneath those hairs live mites, everybody. And those mites are what this dung beetle uses to navigate. And they originally imported dung beetles to Australia. There's a mite. There, middle left of your screen, you can see one moving there. Now, that's the navigator. That helps this dung beetle find dung. And when they took these things to Australia in order to deal with the incredible fly problem they had there, you've all seen the Australians with the corks swinging from their hats. Well, they took dung beetles there to deal with the sheep dung. And unfortunately, the dung beetles couldn't do anything about it because they cleansed them of the mites. And that's how they discovered one day, believe it or not, that this is how dung beetles find their dung, with mites. Look at that little mite. Anyway, we are going to release this fellow now, and he will go away. Now, when you return from the very short break that we're going to have now, Jamie will be still on the hunt for the leopards, Brent will be looking around for the lions, and Steph will show you some sort of survival skill, I've no doubt. We'll find something in this tent. See you just now. Now, internet viewers, of course, we are on an imaginary ad break. I'm going to now release this fellow. Well, in fact, we may as well have a look at one of the others, because there are at least three different species of dung beetle here. We've got the bronze one, as identified by our fossicker-in-chief. Should we introduce our fossicker-in-chief? I think we should. She's just over there. That is Taylor, the fossicker-in-chief, everybody.
I come bearing gifts.
She comes bearing gifts. Taylor, bear your gift. Bring it in here. Ah, thank you so much.
Trying to woo
That's
Jamie.
Very sweet. Right, come and have a look at this. In fact, I'm going to save this flower for the television audience. That is because it is so spectacular, it is not to be missed by anyone. Now, look at this dung beetle. You can see a totally different species. I don't know what species it is. Like I say, there are 700 or so of them. Let's have a look here. Now, just remember, as I find this, we are, of course, just as live in the tent as we are out on drive. So you can ask any questions you like. There you are. You can't ask the dung beetle. He won't know what you're talking about. He doesn't speak English. He only speaks dung. But you can ask me, hashtag Safari Live, and that's the best way to get hold of us. And, of course, we will tell the TV audience that when they get back. Now, from one dung beetle, let's head across to Jamie Patterson and find how her search is going.
Well, we found something very large and that we'd probably have to work quite hard to miss. Hello, boy. Don't even... Thank you, boy. A massive elephant bull that is trailing the elephant breeding herd that we were with earlier. As you know, this is a live wildlife broadcast coming from the middle of the African bush, and these animals are 100% wild. Which means that moments like that are always a possibility. There's no massive aggression from this particular elephant bull. He did give us a little bit of a head shake as he was walking towards us, but it was more as if to say, hey, listen, I'm coming closer to you, just you behave yourself. He's now proceeding to devour a sicklebush tree. This particular elephant, like a lot of our elephants, what are you planning? Ah, just shifting it around. We'll discuss this in a little bit more detail once our imaginary television audiences are back. But one thing that you can clearly see on this particular elephant is how prominent his bones are, particularly his spine and his hip bones. One of the many animals out here that has struggled his way through the drought. Hey, big boy. I wouldn't say that he's a particularly old elephant bull, but you can see he's not in the best of conditions. However, he, unlike the rest of the elephant herd, has most definitely spent a little bit of time in the mud, which is something I'm quite sorry we didn't get a chance to witness. Giving us a demonstration of just how tough an elephant's foot truly is as he walks past and over the sicklebush thorns. Okay, let's see if this gentleman will be kind enough to allow us to view him as he strolls along the road. Out we go. Let's go and catch up with him. I think I know this elephant bull. I think I've encountered him a few times recently, usually around this Twin Dams area. Quite a polite elephant. And by polite, I just mean that he's very comfortable around vehicles, not in any way concerned with the presence of the vehicles moving about him or people speaking or anything like that. Hey, big boy. And welcome back to all of our television viewers. If you are joining us for the first time, perhaps this is your first live safari event. My name is Jamie and we are coming to you live from the middle of this South African bushveld. And right over here is the indisputed king of the African bush, a massive male elephant who has stopped for a little bit of a snack on his way to follow the rest of the elephant herds. Now, I always feel incredibly fortunate that we are allowed to spend, or are privileged enough to spend time with these amazing animals, that they allow us into their lives and continue as they would as if we were not there. There is something truly phenomenal about elephants. They are my favorite animal to sit and spend time with. They're always up to something interesting, whether it's the way that they're feeding, and of course they do feed a very large percentage of their day is spent feeding, or whether it's their interactions with each other. There's something unbelievably intelligent and sentient about an elephant when they walk up to you and when they look at you in the eye. There is definitely a very intelligent being looking back at you. I'm not sure if that's something you've ever experienced wherever you happen to be in the world. And if you have experienced a moment like that, perhaps you've... Oh, look, he's having a scratch. He's scratching the mud that's layered over his body. If you have had a magical experience with elephants or something similar, perhaps you'd like to share that with us, and you can do that by using the hashtag on Twitter. And what a polite gentleman this elephant bull is being. Not at all bothered by the presence of the vehicle, and far more concerned with getting as much food as he possibly can. Which is fair enough, because all of our animals have just come out of an extreme drought. In fact, I'm not even sure if it's not too early to say that we are out of the drought itself. And for a massive elephant that needs to eat roughly, for a bull like that, probably just under 300 kilograms of food per day, close on to 700 pounds of food, for a bull elephant to not be able to reach its nutritional requirements make things incredibly difficult. And he has done it, he has survived and is looking good. Now, in contrast, of course, to the herbivores of this area, the drought has benefited a couple of creatures particularly well. Let's head across and look at some of them with Brent.
Well, as you can see, not much has changed here. He's moved around a little bit and rolled over. And a lot of you at home might think the most dangerous thing out here for us is being this close. I mean, we're probably about 10 feet away from a massive male lion. But the real danger is next to Brian. And he unkindly deposited it right next to us. Now, if you ever drive over lion feces, it really, really, really smells like rotting meat. And so far, it smells like rotting meat so much that those blow flies, which are carrion flies, are attracted to it, and they'll actually lay their eggs in it. Vultures will eat it. Jackal will sometimes eat it. So even a lion feces is an ecosystem in itself. Now, of course, Brian is quite worried that those flies fly from there and land on his nose or his thumb. But fortunately, they're a fly species that don't really land on us. They're not like house flies or stable flies that are quite attracted to us. They tend to stick to decaying meat feces. Now, I've gone for a little wander a little bit to the north of us to look for the rest of the pride. I wasn't able to spot them, so I think they must be a little bit further to the south. So we are going to try to find those cubs a little bit later, and we had to come past these beautiful lions. Now, the Birmingham Coalition, who are much loved at the moment, and when they first arrived, they were not. They were the evil marauders from the north who killed quite a few different adult lionesses and two sub-adult lionesses from the Inkahuma pride. But that is what happens with lions. Now that they're set up as the dominant males in this area, they are fathers to 8 wonderful new cubs. So even though they managed to kill 4 lions, They've already replaced them with another 8. And the amber-eyed lioness, you will get to know very well if you stick with us on Safari Live. She, I am very, very sure she's pregnant as well. Hi, Debbie. Debbie's wondering, when was the last time all four Birmingham boys were seen together? It wasn't that long ago, Debbie, in Torchwood, I think, maybe a week or two. But we definitely seem to see more of this male who's got the hole in his face and the other one who's got a split lip. And we can visibly see his canine than we do the others. Although when we're on cheetah plains, we sometimes do see the others, but they do still meet up. And these guys will wander all the way down to cheetah plains. Of course, the Birmingham Coalition, 3 different plaids that they lord over. Our beloved Nkuhumas, the slightly bedraggled Sticks, and a pride I have never been lucky enough to see, but it spends most of its time in Kruger, called the Torchwood Pride. Now, we're chatting about the amber-eyed lioness, who hopefully will be giving birth soon, so she's going to be looking for a den site. Now, apparently Steph's got one, and I don't know of what.
This is the perfect den site, and very similar to where the youngest cubs of that pride that you were just with, the Nkuhuma pride, were born. They were also born in a shelter just like this, and very often, because of the lack of rocky outcrops out here, these are the only den sites that the lions are born in. And I'm sitting in the perfect one. I've seen lions with tiny cubs in sites like this, I don't know, 20, 30, 40 times over the last 18 years I've been in the bush, and this to me is just perfect. It has a covering of a tree, which in summertime, when the most cubs are born, will be covered in foliage. It also is very thorny. I don't know if you can have a look and see, but this tree above us is just covered in the most viciously hooked thorns. It also has lots of little hiding places underneath the fallen down trees of this jackalberry that is has been felled by, well, not jackalberry, excuse me, a combretum that's been felled by an elephant, creating just the perfect alcove over here. Isn't this just wonderful? Nice. And it's got a good, it has a good entrance and exit point for mom. When she comes and goes, young cubs will be left on their own for around about, well, not left on their own, but they'll be in a den site secluded from the rest of the pride for about 8 weeks. Mom will move, mom lion will move those cubs from time to time. She'll move them every few days because the den site picks up a smell of the lion, and she'd want to reduce any, basically any trace of those lions. Those youngsters, let me come out here. I am bleeding in several places from being hooked by these thorns, I'll be honest with you. And I heard some there's a giraffe there. Shows you, you start hiding out in the bush and all things come and play. I was hearing some noises. We can just see the chest of that giraffe. Let's see if we can get him a good view for you. Give us 10 seconds. We're just going to go into that open clearing there. You should be able to see from there. Right, just checking our wind direction. It's important with giraffe. Oh, he's a massive bull. Come, let's see. We'll be able to get him for you just in a couple of seconds. Got his head coming through. There we go. Oh, so much bigger than what we are. A bull giraffe, I'll be able to walk underneath his chest. Have a look at that. Absolutely fantastic. He's been standing underneath that tree during the hottest part of the day. That is a torchwood tree, and it's absolutely fantastic for giraffe because the foliage is so high off the ground. Gives a good bit of shade for that giraffe. I know it's a male because he's just so big. Not only that, but from this distance even, I can see the top of his horns are bald, just like myself. And of course, that is the diagnostic feature of a giraffe, having bald tips of its horns. If it was tufted, looking like a paintbrush, it would be a female. That there is a giraffe. Let's see how close we can get to him. I don't really want to disturb him, but if we can get a little bit closer for you, I'm sure you wouldn't mind. So let's just check the wind direction. I'm using a sock filled with some ash. The wind direction is basically blowing there, just past him. And I think if we go a little bit here, we'd be able to get another view of him. Let's see if we can get a full-bodied view for you. Now, Cameron, you wanted to know if giraffes make sounds. Cameron, they do actually do make sounds. They just make it very infrequently. So the only time I've ever heard a giraffe actually make a noise is when it's had some lions attached to it, and also when two giraffe bulls have been fighting with one another. Other than that, giraffes are virtually silent, but they can make noises. This is about the best that we could hope for on foot. And the reason for that is that animals see humans on foot as the predators we are. And our general shape and size has been utilizing these animals for the last hundreds of thousands of years. And they're all sort of genetically programmed to fear us instinctively. Now you can see that giraffe has very little to fear from us. We're standing about 100 yards away. But what we are going to do is we are going to move away from this giraffe. You saw that little circle that he gave there? That was just the first signs of his unrest and unease. And it's what tells me, let's create some distance. We don't want to chase him away from his shade. So we're going to carry on with our walk today and find some more interesting things to show you. And in the meantime, we're going to be sending you over to James in the tent.
Hello, everybody. I'm just doing some running repairs. You know, out here, of course, the tent does take a bashing in the elements. Now, I thought I'd show you a map. Just one second. Sorry about that. The sound was on in there. It was making a horrible noise. I was hearing my own voice, and nobody should have to do that, as you're well aware. Now, you would have seen often, of course, those amazing artists when they draw in front of you and a picture emerges from nothing. That's not going to happen now. What we have here is a map of Juma. I'm going to show you where everyone is. You've just been with Steph. He is knocking about over here. That's him there. There we are. He can be red today. We won't give him any hair because he doesn't have any. Brent is over here. All right, that's Brent there. He has got lots of hair. Okay, and he's also sitting next to, of course, an enormous pile of dung. Yuck. Right, and he's with a lion. Where's my orange Koki pen? This is a disaster egg, but here we go. I've got it. He's sitting next to a lion there. You can see that's a lion, can't you, Eggsy? Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, big lion. All right, and then Jamie is knocking about not too far from Steph, actually. She's over here. Round about, in fact, I think she's a little bit further down. We'll put her over there. That's her there. She's got a skirt on. You can see she doesn't really, but it signifies lady. Lots of hair. And she is, of course, with an elephant. Here's an elephant, or she was with an elephant. There we go. Does that look like an elephant, Eggsy? I thought it did. Now, quickly, what I wanted to show you just before we go off to our break, which is in exactly 1 minute, so I'm going to have to do this very fast. What we have here is Juma. This is Juma. That's where the three vehicles are. Now, just along here is Cheetah Plains. You heard Brent talking about Cheetah Plains there. That's that there. That's Juma. This will make sense eventually. And that's Arethusa. That's the other place that we traverse. And when you return from your short break, you can go and make some coffee if you like. Perhaps pour yourself your favorite tipple. And we will see you back again. In fact, I have enough time to show you. What I'm going to show you quickly here is the territory of the Nkuhuma Pride and the territory of the Styx Pride, both of which are encompassed by the big Birmingham boys. About 10,000 acres each, those two territories. So the Birmingham Pride, 20 to 30,000 acres. When you come back, more of the lions, hopefully the cubs, and with any luck, a leopard or two. See you shortly. Now, internet, our faithful followers, thank you for putting up with my drawing. I do wonder sometimes how the new television viewers see these kinds of things. In fact, were I to look at that map, were I to look at that piece of paper, and, well, somebody were to tell me it was a map, I'd be sore tempted to tell them they were talking absolute nonsense. Let's perhaps modify it slightly. We'll just do the sticks there. There we go. And we'll just draw the kahumas there. You know what I used to say to myself, Iggy? In fact, I say it quite often myself. I say that simplicity is the best route. Wouldn't you agree with me? Right, here we are. Sorry about that, everyone. Okay, that's all I have to show you on this map. I think let's put these back here. I've put a splinter in my hand. I feel very embarrassed. Let's put this back in here. Then we'll go back into the tent. And while I get back into the tent and my red face starts to go slightly less red, let's head across to Jamie and find out how her search for Karula is going.
Still no sign of a Karula, but I'm doing quite well in terms of managing to find all the other animals that are not leopards, in this case an entire herd of buffalo. There were about 200 buffalo in front of me earlier. There are no more buffalo in front of me. Oh no, that's not true. I can very clearly see a tiny patch of brown skin there. Perfect. Well done, Viam. Exactly where I meant. And just like that, the buffalo herd has disappeared off into the dense vegetation. I'm going to try and get around to them. I'm hoping they're just cutting a corner and that we'll meet up with them on the other side. I think they're on their way towards Buffleshoek Dam. It's difficult to tell though, they have had a drink already. And if they continue to move in the direction that they're moving in, the first thing they're going to do is attract the attention of those lions once again. Viam has spotted something. Oh, how wonderful. Very well spotted, Viam. There is a very large giraffe. You see, we're finding all the animals that are not leopards this afternoon. Hello, big boy. I hear that Steph was just with a giraffe on foot. Oh, we've got this massive male making his way out in front of us. Oh, at least he has decided not to be camera shy in the same way our buffalo were. Well, where is Steph, I wonder? Could this be the same giraffe? There are, of course, more than one giraffe on Juma. Oh, it might be a different male. He is sort of glancing across to the side of him. I think it is the same giraffe. In which case, Steph, there's a buffalo herd here as well, if you're interested. You see how he's looking across back over the drainage line and not at us? And that's either because he's trying to figure out what is there, or it's because he spotted Steph. And Jandre. Who knows? I'm not sure exactly where Steph is. I'm sure he is somewhere in that general vicinity. Look how odd his neck looks. I don't know if it's just from my angle, but it looks really out of alignment. Like there's a massive bend in it. I think it is just the angle that we're sitting at, but it does look very, very peculiar. And off our giraffe goes as well. Let's try and catch up with him. Everybody wave to Steph. I think he's somewhere here. Let's see if we can spot him as we try and get a better view of the giraffe. I may, of course, be talking absolute nonsense, and it might have absolutely nothing to do with Steph. That is also entirely possible. Ah, that's pretty conclusive. Apparently Steph's GPS is right next to ours, or showing him right next to us. So then, yes, in that case it is indeed Steph. What a happy coincidence. Excuse me, mister. Do you mind if we join you for just a few moments? Thank you very much. You're looking very statuesque there. No, there is something wrong with this giraffe's neck. is slightly oddly shaped, just slightly skew. Oh dear, Mr. Giraffe, don't you know there's 30 seconds to TV left? No, he doesn't. And welcome back to all of our television audiences. I hope you are having a marvelous live safari journey so far. My name is Jamie, the gentleman behind the camera is Viam, and we have an amazing massive animal to show you. Just a few moments ago, Steph was on foot with this spectacular male giraffe. We are now on a vehicle with this spectacular male giraffe. So all in all, this male giraffe is becoming quite the celebrity. The first thing I've noticed about him is that he's got a slightly skew neck, which I have never seen before in a giraffe. I don't know, it's not the angle that we're seeing him at, because I've checked it a few times now from a couple of different approaches, and there's definitely something that's happened to his neck. It must have dislocated or been out of alignment, or perhaps even some form of giraffe scoliosis, but he really does have a prominent bulge. And his neck goes out of alignment. Doesn't seem to be doing him any harm at all. He looks perfectly healthy. The odd bald patch that you might see on his skin is relatively normal for a giraffe out here. They often get fungal infections of the skin, or occasionally viruses like a variation of the herpes virus. See him looking back in the direction that Steph was in. We know that he's a male, of course, the massive size and the bigger, powerful neck and ossicones on the top of his neck, on top of his head. River, who is 9 years old. River, always, always lovely to hear from you. I'm so glad you're watching our safari this afternoon. River, you want to know if a giraffe would ever chase a person. Our River, yes, possibly. It's very, very unusual. Most of the time, the giraffe will just run away from the person concerned. But sometimes, every now and again, particularly with big dark males like this one, they get a little bit cross and they go after people. There's an incredible video, River, of a giraffe even chasing somebody in the car. And believe it or not, I've been chased by a giraffe. Now here, River, you're probably going to laugh at me a little bit because it was a baby giraffe. It wasn't even a fully grown big giraffe. But a baby giraffe is still taller than Brent and much, much heavier. And it was actually quite scary. This particular baby giraffe had been rescued and it had been hand-raised in a wildlife rehabilitation center. And it kept charging me. It kept coming to chase me. And it really seriously was one of the most intimidating encounters I have had with any of the wild animals out here. And I've walked lions and buffalo and elephant and all kinds of things. But for some reason, being charged by a baby giraffe, which sounds ridiculous, and you can all laugh wherever you are at home until it happens to you. It's probably unlikely to happen to you, but you never know. Stranger things have happened out here. He, on the other hand, is perfectly content to just keep an eye on us. And the entire buffalo herd that is moving through this block. So there's a whole load of buffalo, about 200 of them, just out of sight. I'm going to catch up with them. In the meantime, let's head across to Brent and see how he's doing with his fluffy little lions.
Right next to us. This is live and we have a lion less than a foot away from my cameraman, Brian. There's a lion cub, but behind Brian, we are being landmined in. So we found the rest of the pride down in the riverbed. And literally they've been, that's the amber-eyed. Was that amber-eyes? No, not. One of the moms. But you can hear that low growl. I think she's hot. We are literally, at the moment, surrounded by lions. And we are in the middle of Africa. We've got a bunch over here. And one going this way, one going that way. We don't know where to look. Here we go. Now, you can see my car tracks
It's the only way to get in here. And unfortunately, I think we are being hemmed in with landmines. It is getting quite smelly down here. But fortunately, cubs are active at this time of the day. So there we go. There's a couple of them. Oh, there we go. Look at that. Look at those fat little tummies as they walk back after relieving themselves. Now, well, hello to Deborah's 9-year-old grandson. Deborah's 9-year-old grandson, I'd love to hear your name, but he'd like to know, why is their scat or their dung so runny? Well, because they've been eating a lot of protein, a lot of meat, and they also digest what they eat very, very quickly. And actually, just have a look at this one here, Brian. Now, you'll notice a funny little mark on that one. It looks a little bit wet. Now, lions can be quite disgusting animals, as much as we love our incredible Nkuhumas. Every now and then, they do something that... Brian, what was your exact wording when you saw it? No, you just said, no! No! The lioness stood up and urinated on the sleeping cub, and the cub did not...
Hello everybody, you might hear a small echo. Now, what I'm doing, Ronald had a bit of a problem, everyone, but he's back at the dam cam, and what I wanted to show you quickly, sorry about the loss of the lions, we'll go back to them. We are, of course, broadcasting to you live from the African wild, and Brent is in a particularly difficult area. He's down in a dry riverbed there, which makes signal a little bit difficult, but he will no doubt rectify the situation shortly. Now, let's have a look at Ronald. Let's go to the dam camera first. There's Ronald. There we are. There is Ronald, everyone. You can see him there. And I had to park him in the shade. You can see I've skillfully done that. And that's because he overheated somewhat. Let's have a quick look at his view now. There he is. That's him looking out over, waiting for some friends. He's a bit lonely at the moment. He's hoping that a friend or two will come and join him. Now, just before we try and re-establish contact with the lions, let's have a look at what I've got under the microscope here. What we have is a very special little flower, and the flower is called plumbago. There it is. Doesn't look particularly amazing as it is now, but just watch this. What we'll do is we'll move the microscope, and I'll just focus in on the flower itself. There we go. Now, many of you will wonder what on earth those blue lines are. Those blue lines, everybody, emit ultraviolet radiation, so they reflect ultraviolet that comes from the sun. That in turn is seen by a specific kind of insect. I'm not sure which insect it is. I have seen these flowers being drunk from by something called a citrus swallowtail, which is a beautiful butterfly, black and yellow butterfly. So maybe that's what sees this ultraviolet. It comes down, it sticks its proboscis down into the bowels of that little flower there, and in so doing gathers pollen and also deposits it. Now that looks to me like deposited pollen. That pollen will then go down into the bottom of the flower and it will form a little fruit. Now, I'm just going to move the microscope around a bit. Let's have a look, see here. And what we can see is this amazing ability of the flower to propagate itself. And what we'll do, let me just focus in nicely there. There we go. Look at this. You see those little droplets? Can you see those beautiful little droplets? Those are very, very sticky, and that is how this flower propagates. The seeds form those very sticky little, well, they've got those sticky burrs on them, and then as an animal walks past or a bird comes past and sits there for a while, so these flowers will stick to them, and they'll carry them off into the wild, and they'll be settled again down in a dry riverbed, perhaps, where there's some water and there's shade. And that is exactly where Brent Leo Smith is now with his lions.
Sorry about disappearing there. We are in the bottom of a river system, so I've just moved to where I hope our antenna can see each other a bit better. So, isn't this amazing? We're alive in the middle of the African bush. We're sitting next to the incredible Nkuhuma Pride, who is, well, definitely one of the stars of Safari Live.
and we've got 8 cubs at the moment, and hopefully the amber-eyed lioness who's got her back to us is going to give birth in the next 6 weeks or so. Just now we had a question from Deborah's 9-year-old grandson, whose name is Cameron. So, hi Cameron, nice to meet you, great to have you with us. I hope you are loving the Nkuma lions just like Brian and myself are. So, here we go. And that's the nice thing, there's always a cub who's up around growling, suckling. And that's the nice thing about little lions, they're not as lazy as big lions. And you can see the pride has fed well. They killed a female buffalo last night. Oh, look at that. That is a passed out little lion. And they're now digesting. Now what they've done is they moved into this dry river system. Now it's a little bit cooler down here in the sand. So that's the main reason why they probably moved all the way down here. Now the first two lions we saw earlier are part of this group, except that young female, as she's about to come into estrus, that other male up there is just keeping her away from not so much the pride but the second male who's down here. Now it's not uncommon during an estrus cycle for a lioness to mate with multiple males, so this guy might be waiting for his chance as the other male becomes fatigued after mating to see if he can go in there, box his friend and coalition mate, and take a turn. And also, it has been recorded through genetic studies that a lioness who has got 3 cubs, now in our case here we've got a 4 male lion coalition, and a lioness that's got 3 cubs could have 3 cubs sired by 3 different males. Now I've just got an update in my ear about the other 2 members, the 2 male lions that form up the Birmingham boys, and they are about 5 or 6 kilometers to the east of us with their 3rd pride that they lord over, the Torchwood pride, a pride I've never seen before but would really love to. And now we're going to sit here just in case something stumbles into the riverbed and the lions go from flat to awake in a split second. While we do that, let's go see what Steph's up to on foot.
You know, welcome back to the bushwalk over here with myself, Steph. And I have this saying in my mind, look what the cat dragged in. But in this particular case, I think I have to say, look what the ant bear dragged in. An ant bear was feeding here probably a day or two ago and has dug up an unexpected delight for me to be able to show you, which is this tuber. Now, this tuber was dug out not for the ant bear to eat. The ant bear eats termites, but this belongs to a very basically nondescript little plant. The plant I think it belongs to is that one right over there that's growing on top of the termite mound. But it's because I cannot 100% identify this particular tuber that I'm not going to do the whole experiment I want to show you, but I will be able to do most of it I want to show you. Tubers, have a look at how swollen that is. They contain lots of starch. Not only do they contain lots of starch, but they also contain lots of water. And our water is an incredibly precious resource. And it's one of the things I remember from my earliest days of watching wilderness TV or watching outdoor television, you know, all these channels that we used to have and have at the moment, Nat Geo Wild, one of them. I remember this as being one of my very first favorite things to watch from a bushman. They had a tuber like this. They obviously knew which exact plant it came from. Obviously, the best way to do that is to dig up the tuber after identifying the plant. But what they did is they split the tuber like I'm doing now. And you can already see how much water is inside this particular one. They then grated it. Oopsie. I'm trying to do everything too fast, you see. Grated it. And then they squeezed it basically into their shell. And the way they did that was they inverted their hands, mushed it all together,
can just have a look at that water just pouring out of there. Isn't that amazing? My hands are incredibly dirty, of course, which is... So Brenda, hello Brenda, you've just asked me, is this like a wild yam? Brenda, it probably is very similar to a wild yam. I know after studying plants here, a lot of the plants in Africa have this type of tuber, but because I don't know where the flowering parts of this plant are, it's difficult for me to tell you exactly what this is, but a type of one of those plants. Have a look when you grate it, have a look at the difference in water that comes out. And all that fluid basically came from that much pulp. Isn't that incredible? I mean, if you were thirsty out here, you could definitely get yourself a decent amount of water. Obviously, you'd take a little bit more care not to get as much dirt into it as I have. So let's see. Here we've got that much pulp. Squeeze that. Into that much water. That's amazing. So obviously the lesson here is that there can be water found almost anywhere and for almost, and if you know where to look. But, and this is a big but, you need to be safe about what you do. Tubers can also harbor and store some quite toxic elements, and what you don't want to do is you don't want to go and drink this unless you 100% absolutely know what it is. It's amazing getting all this liquid out here. Wow. And I haven't even finished my first slice and I have four of them. Yes. I'll do that again just because I feel like doing it. Wow. Nice. What does it taste like? Obviously, you can do the toxin taste. If it's very bitter, it's a good thing to leave it alone. If it burns your tongue or burns the inside of your lips, absolutely don't taste it. If it gives you tummy rumbles or cramps within an hour of drinking your first little sip, leave it, and then you can start off with a cupful and then you can have more. That's how you taste test this for toxicity. Right, but I think we're going to leave you at that. I need to obviously clean my hands and get myself ready for the next send you over to James in the tent.
Hello everybody, welcome back to the tent. My name is James Hendry. If you were wondering out there, Steph, you've just met Brent's with the lions, Jamie's looking for leopards. You're on a live safari in the northeast corner of the world's most beautiful country. That is South Africa, and we're in the iconic Kruger National Park, live from the African wild, and it's a great joy to have you with us. Hashtag Safari Live if you'd like to talk to us on Twitter. Ask us questions, send us your comments, send us your impressions. What I have here in my hand is something that is trying to escape. It is a garden variety cricket. It's called a common garden cricket. There it is. It's very dark, says my dear friend Egbert, the cameraman. Let's have a look here. On the microscope, it won't be quite so dark because the microscope has its own very special... What I'm showing you there, everyone, remember I showed you the beetle, and the beetle had the elytra, and the elytra being the back wing modified into a shell. This is a cricket from a totally different order of insects, and you can see it doesn't have that. It's got those four wings that it uses to fly. Then, as we go back, look at the tail. Look at the tail there. Isn't that lovely? And that's probably a female cricket with an ovipositor. In other words, a tube to lay eggs. Now, this is the cricket that you can hear going crick, 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 either at night or when I make a joke. Off you go. Be free. Right. Now, George, you're 10 years old and you want to know if we get stink bugs here. George, let me tell you, we get some foul, foul stink bugs here. We get the common sort of a greeny shield bugs is the proper name for them, a shield bug. that we also, on say 3 or 4 summer nights after some rain, we can be sitting around having our supper, and suddenly there will be the emergence or arrival of thousands of tiny little black bugs like that size, and they come and they sit in our food, and they get in our ears, and they get in our noses, and they get in our mouths, and they taste disgusting. Well, disgusting to most of us. For those of you who like coriander, they taste just like a Thai curry. Yuck. Now, come over here. I just want to quickly complete what I was telling you a little bit earlier. Here we've got this ridiculous map, and I must apologize for my artistic skills. I shall berate my parents when I next see them for not passing on some better skills. But what we had here, just to recap, was the Nkuhuma Pride's territory, the Styx Pride's territory, 10,000 acres each. But Brent just mentioned the Torchwood Pride, and they go into the Kruger National Park. They sit about there. And that's about the average overlap that you get between prides of lions. And the Kruger National Park boundary is there. And what's very important for you to understand is that there are no fences. So we're part of 8.5 million acres of contiguous wildlife land. These animals don't go anything like that far. Some of the elephants that you saw do go well into Mozambique. Even the park stretches into Mozambique and north into Zimbabwe. So we're really privileged to be here in a particularly enormous and beautiful piece of African wildlife land. Let's head across back to the Nkuhuma Pride and find out what the little cubbies are doing now.
Most of them are taking a time to have a cat nap. But there are a few up at the back that are still up and moving. And my name is Brent. We're live in the African bush. I've got my good friend Brian on camera. And together we're known as the killer bees.
Killer bees.
Yes, because we find all the killer sightings. Now, and if you want to ask us any questions, hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. And let's look at these gorgeous lions as they laze about in the afternoon shade. Now, a sleeping adult lion is majestic, but not quite as cute as a little cub. And they're always sort of up to something. They don't sleep as much as the adults. Hi, Emma. Emma's wondering, what is the largest litter a lioness can have? The largest litter in the wild recorded was 6 little cubs. Sorry, 8 cubs. I apologize. 8 cubs in the Maasai Mara in Kenya is the largest litter ever recorded. Generally, it's between 1 and 3, you can say, is an average sized litter. So in this scenario here, 2 of the lionesses had 3 cubs and the third had 2. And how many will Amber Eyes have? That is a question we're only going to be able to answer in a little while. Oh, rollover time. Now, lions will roll over frequently during the day. And as the patch of sand they've been sleeping on gets very hot, they roll over to a new cool patch. And in some cases, they might get up and move a little bit. Now, if we come out a little bit wider and we have a careful look. It is a bit difficult, but you can just see, where's my hand? Oh, there's my hand. You can just see there's some flattened areas all around where the pride's been lying during the day, and as the sun has moved, or they have moved, or as that piece of sand has got warm, they have moved. Now, I am hoping that they might get up and go for a drink. The water hole where James has got his rover is not too far away from here. And wouldn't it be incredible? Oh, look there. So speaking about having a drink, the cubs don't have to go to the water hole. I'm not letting go, Mom. Even if you roll over, I'm staying attached. So even though these cubs are already eating meat, they start eating meat from as young as sort of 5 weeks old. They will be reliant on their mother's milk till they're about 6 months old. And that is when they lose their milk.
We're live. Sorry about that, everybody. I was singing a small song about a fly called the tsetse fly, which actually has an interesting story around this area. I do apologize. Anyway, the tsetse fly is, many of you will have heard of, it causes a disease called trypanosomiasis, which is otherwise known as sleeping sickness, a very foul disease to get. But the tsetse fly was removed from this area by a disease introduced into East Africa by European settlers called the rinderpest. And the rinderpest took out ungulate populations, that's antelope and bovids, so the buffalo and the impala and the kudu and the nyala, and all of those animals died in huge numbers in around about 1896. And that mercifully cleared out the tsetse fly, which in turn opened this whole area up for habitation. Now, you wouldn't have learnt that incredible story if I hadn't been singing like a complete moron when you came over here. Now, the other thing I have to show you is, ooh, he seems to have, good grief, you know what's happened here? I just want to show you something. You see that, everybody? That there was a millipede. That millipede was resident in that jar with the cricket I showed you. The cricket clearly chopped him in half. How very strange. Anyway, let's have a look at the millipede. I'll try and get the millipede's head, because that's the most interesting bit. No, that's not the head. Oh dear, that's quite scary. We have a look now. That's not the head, obviously, but you can see still the millipede's nerve reactions going there. I found the head now. I'm absolutely astounded by that. That was murdered by that cricket. Right, let's put the head underneath there. The head is still being rather recalcitrant. It doesn't want to stop moving. There we are. Let me just change the focus slightly. Oops. Oops. There we are. And there is the head. So you can see the eyes. There's that little kind of black thing with lens on it. And you can see the feelers, which are used to, of course, sense various sort of signals from the air, if you like. It's what an animal like this uses to smell. Now, remember, this is not an insect. It's part of an entirely different class of animal. In the same way that a fish is not a bird, this is not an insect. It is a myriapod, or thousand foot, if you like. Right. That's what we have there. Now, I'm not going to do any more singing, but I am going to tell you a little bit about the springtime. Now, the springtime, of course, for me, one of the most joyous times of the year, and I'm sure for all of you as well. And the things that we get in spring, of course, we get grasses, which we'll look at under the microscope as well. And we also just get these beautiful flowers. And this flower is called Indigophora. And Indigophora, as its name might suggest, was used, I think it was the roots that were used to produce indigo dye. That's why it's called Indigophora, and it's a member of the pea family. Isn't that pretty? We'll have a quick look under the microscope, and I'll just show you how, as with the plumbago we looked at, with its runways of ultraviolet, this flower has been especially designed to attract insects. There we go. And you can see it's shaped specially. I don't know what insect it is that that pollinates this little flower, but you can see it's shaped specially to catch or receive this particular insect. And what's interesting, and what you'll find with most flowers out here, is that as they get, the more colorful they are, the less they smell. And it seems that mostly the white flowers out here are smelly, and they attract birds most of the time. Right, let's head back across to Brent. I won't be singing, just in case he loses signal again. Just remember, it is because he is in a very deep drainage line, and we, of course, are broadcasting to you live from the great Kruger National Park, iconic national park of the world. But the lions, I see, are back on track.
Fortunately, you didn't miss too much. The lions are still a-schnoozing. One lioness has got up and moved away. The cubs started irritating her, and she's gone through there. So, as James said, we are in a drainage line. If Brian shows you the walls here, so it's probably about 15 to 20 feet, depending on where we are, to where the normal ground is above us. And we do apologize, but as we are live, and we have no control about where the wild animals want to go, because they are truly wild. We're in an 8.5 million acre wilderness area. So if the lions want to go down into the dry riverbed, they can, and we will just follow. Remember the hashtag Safari Live.
If you've got any questions about these lions, the incredible Nkuhumas, the master buffalo hunters, they have been incredibly successful over the last few months and weeks. They're averaging about 3 buffalo a week. Now, a big buffalo bull can weigh upward of 2,000 pounds, and a lioness is probably around 350 pounds. But they work as such an incredible cohesive unit to bring down those massive animals. And some of my favorite moments here at Safari Live have been with this pride of lions and following their trials and tribulations. Last year in August, I was very lucky and we got to see the first ever live buffalo takedown. And then a couple of weeks ago, we got to see it again. And I just love spending time with cats, even when they're sleeping. And there's an old adage that my dad taught me: when you're out in the African bush, the most important thing, if you want to see those really great sightings, is patience. And that quite often means a lot of time sitting with sleeping cats. But Ryan, there's nowhere else I'd rather be than in a dry riverbed with a bunch of lions and with a great team like Steph, who's wandering around somewhere on foot.
We found this moth busy. I don't quite know what this moth is doing. It's probably busy dying. Moths have, as we know, an egg phase, a caterpillar phase, and then a moth phase. And this is the moth phase. The moth phase is generally only there in order to find a mate, to mate, to produce eggs, and then to lay eggs. And we found this particular moth on the tree behind us. But what it does give us a chance to do is discuss why moths are furry and why butterflies are not. Have a look at the fur on the edges of the wings of this moth, and also along its body and along its head. Now, apart from decoration and camouflage, another thing that is good for is sound absorption. Moths are primarily nocturnal and fly around at night time, the same time that bats fly around. And we all know that bats use echolocation to find their prey. In other words, they send out a signal that bounces off of an object, and they can detect and draw a picture in their minds based on the reflection of that sound. Amazing, eh? Moths have evolved this furriness so that they absorb those ultrasonic bursts of sound, and that they become almost invisible. Well, not almost, but they become a lot less visible to the bats than moths without the fur. Interesting fact, eh? So that is a moth. I'm going to leave this poor moth here to become food for something tonight. And we're going to talk about this piece of leadwood here. Leadwood stumps like this have been used in Africa for ages and ages as roof supports and as pillars for kraals, where cattle are kept, and to make decorations and also to cook with. It's a very versatile wood. The wood burns quite hot, but very slow and very even, which of course for baking in an oven or for cooking on is exactly what chefs want. They want a fire that they can rely on, and leadwood is one of the best things for it. But we also call it the African ebony, and I'm hoping that I could show you why it's called the African ebony by breaking off a piece of this wood, which I did there with consummate ease, and carving a little bit out of it. There you can see that contrast. It's quite black. In actual fact, the heartwood of this tree would be almost completely black. This is just a little bit black. And very, very, very hard. This is the third hardest tree that we have out here, and probably the heaviest tree that we have out here. Hence its common name, leadwood. It's a type of combretum. They are make up the densest wood that we have here. Funny enough, you can't make a boat from this wood, you will sink. It is not buoyant. That's how dense it actually is. Right, now, a stump like this would probably be in and around the, I would say probably about the 100-150 year mark. How amazing is that? 150 years old, this tree. Probably fell down being hit by lightning. I think the parent tree is this. And quite often they do get hit by lightning. Here's the parent leadwood here. And they sometimes have this fantastic gum that is produced that you can actually collect as a type of sweet. And the bushmen in years past used to actually milk these particular trees. I can't see any gum now. Maybe if I get a bit deeper in here, I'll be able to find see some. But they used to milk these trees and they used to collect their gum as sweets. So the gum from the leadwood tree is used as a sweet for the bushmen and is still collected and harvested today. Not quite as refined as normal sweets, but good net nevertheless. You're going to be going away from us for a short while. Some of you are going to be going away at least. Please don't go anywhere. We'll see you at the end of the ad break. All right, so this is the leadwood, the 101 uses of the leadwood, basically. Very termite resistant because of its density. Very hard, very good to cook with. Produces a sweet. You can carve with it. You can make inlays on you can probably do steak knives or inlays for your table from it. Railway sleepers were made from it back in the day. What else can we do with it, John?
Ash.
Can make some, you can make some toothpaste from the ash. So the tree itself has got quite a coarse bark. And if you burn that bark, it makes quite an abrasive ash. And that you can use as toothpaste. I don't quite know if I want to use that on my teeth as toothpaste. I won't have any teeth left. I don't really want to show you my teeth. All right, let's carry on going. All right, we're going to be making our way through. We're now in the same area that Jamie was a little bit earlier with those buffalo, and I definitely don't want to be talking too loud while I walk through here. So we're going to send you over to James in the tent while we carry on through here and try not to get squashed.
Hello. I was just retrieving something that I had dropped on the floor, and it is in fact the sheath of a Steenbok's skull. Now, some of you would have seen this before, and we're often asked, of course, how big the brains of animals are, and what I quite like about this skull is you can see that a Steenbok, humble and small though he may be, has actually got a fairly large brain, and interestingly it's about the same size as a monkey's brain. Now, a monkey, of course, is an intelligent primate. Well, we think of them as relatively intelligent. We don't tend to think of the humble Steenbok when we think of calculus and complex physical problems. But that brain is roughly the size of, what should we say, a passion fruit or a granadilla? And I think that's pretty big. I know people with smaller brains than that. Anyway, we'll put him back here. And then we've got a question from James S. Dungan. Now, James S. Dungan, you want to know about the stingless bees in the skull, but I'm not going to show them to you yet. I'm going to wait for the TV audience to come back first before we show them to, we'll show you the stingless bees. In the meantime, what I have here is something quite strange, and I'm not entirely sure of its origins. Oh dear, we've lost another piece. The wind has blown. Oh, that's very sad. Oh, there it is. It's okay. Right. Now, you can see that this was a chrysalis. I think you can see that. And a chrysalis, of course, is the special cocoon or home that a caterpillar makes. It spins around itself. It goes hard like this when it goes from caterpillar to butterfly or moth. But what this one has left behind is a bit of the shell, its original shell. And from that, I'm sure a particularly good entomologist will be able to tell you exactly what species it was. But let's have a look at it under the microscope, because the colours and the hairs are quite spectacular. And they've clearly been sloughed off by the adult version of the butterfly. Let's just put it under there nicely. There we are. Look at that. Look at the detail. Look at the hairs. Copper hairs. Beautiful sort of almost blood red, but I suppose it's a bit more orange than it is blood red. And I think that must have come from the top of the caterpillar, and I can think of caterpillars of that color, but I can't think of which species they may have been. Those hairs would have been used for defense, those nasty things that make you itch horribly. Anyway, I think that's rather spectacular. And of course, the whole process by which the metamorphosis through which a caterpillar goes, just amazing. Remember that when it spins its cocoon in here, it liquefies completely. It loses form entirely. It becomes a sludge. And then somehow, some miraculous process occurs inside the chrysalis and it emerges as a butterfly or a moth. Isn't that amazing? Right, 5 seconds to TV, everyone. Welcome back, everybody, to your live safari here on the northeast corner of South Africa, the western fringes of the great Kruger National Park. My name is James Hendry. Upanda is on camera today. Jamie is out looking for leopards. She's actually back in camp, briefly just washing an eye out. Something flew into it. I don't know what it was. Hopefully she's okay. Brent is with the lions, and Steph is scouring the bush for the smaller things. He did find a giraffe, and no doubt he'll be doing some more survival tricks in a little bit of a while. Now, James S. Dungan, while you were away, well, you weren't actually away, but you are, we'll pretend you were, you wanted to know, you're obviously a regular watcher, and you saw that we have some stingless bees in my friend Gerald the giraffe's skull. Now, many of you would have seen these before as the weeks have gone on. Let's have a look. They live in there, you can see, in that little sort of waxy knoll. They love the camera, so we're going to put the camera on them. But what's interesting is that they've been here now for about a year, believe it or not, and, oops, they've been here for about a year, and despite that fact, they love the camera. He's just flown off into the microscope. Let me just take that away. Sorry, let's come back here. No, don't stay in there. He's in here. There, he's gone. He's going. He will go off and do what he does. Now let's just go back here again. Now what's in there's another one. What's interesting to me is that this thing has hardly grown. So that is Sarah the stingless bee. Of course, we had Simon's just left. I'm talking nonsense. I've no idea whether they're male or female. They're most likely female because bees in a hive normally are. And this thing has not grown in a year. So they build it very slowly. I guess it's just waste product. But they do love the camera, so let's just zoom slightly into the depths of the hole there. And one day I'd really like to actually get in there and have a proper look. Let me just turn the light up a bit. Ooh, there we are. You liked that, didn't you? Little bee. Isn't that sweet? Oh, flying out now. I think it's the heat. I'm going to let them out. I think let's come back this side. I don't want to trap them. There we go. They'll come back, they'll go and gather some pollen and gather some nectar. They'll go back in there, they'll make the delightfully sort of citrusy sour honey that they make. Makes probably a little grape-sized thing every year, so very little honey they make. Anyway, not so sweet smelling, of course, or tasting the air around which Brent Leo Smith is surrounded. It is green with the stink of lion dung. Let's have a look.
James is definitely not lying. We are literally surrounded by lion dung at the moment. And if we have a look carefully, I thought I heard some elephants up ahead, so they could come down here. And elephants don't like predators. They often will chase them, so we might get some action yet. But there is a very sweet scene happening right next to us. And it's a little lion cub suckling away. A peaceful moment between a mother and a cub. Stressful with their hunts at the moment. Rain, who's 16, is wondering, will it be harder for them to hunt once the rains come in earnest? It will be. As soon as those buffalo start picking up condition, those old boys, those old buffalo bulls, and the breeding herds, also they'll spread out a bit more, they won't be so focused on certain areas. So it will be a little bit difficult, a little bit more difficult, but they are such incredible hunters, and that even when buffalo are in good condition, they seem to have a high success rate in hunting. Now, one of the wonderful things about what we do is we live and breathe the African bush, and this particular pride we have had such magical moments with. Now, just to share a few with you, I think one of my favorites in the last couple of weeks was on foot, and we were on bushwalk, and we were tracking their footprints through the bush, trying to find where they went. And we heard this amazing low contact call of a lioness communicating with another. Ow! 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 And we could just hear it. And then we went a little bit further, and just peeking through the bush at us was one of the adult Nkuhumas. And I've had many encounters, probably more than 50, with the Nkuhuma pride on foot. And some of them have been a little bit scary, some of them have been quite sweet. But it is incredible that we are able to spend this massive amount of time we do with these lions. And the amazing thing is we get to share it with you live from the middle of Africa to wherever you might be. Now, there's a lot of dung spread through this little river system, and Brian has spotted that there, and that's a question from Drew in Washington, D.C. And that dung over there is elephant. Now, let's see, how many dungs can we find around the lions? Now, that's elephant dung. That is, if we have a quick squiz, let's have a look. And we come a bit closer to us, and we happen to be downwind at the moment. There is there, right next to us, a very large lioness leaving. Not quite as large as the male leaving we saw a bit earlier. So that's lion dung. Now lion dung comes in lots of different shapes and sizes depending on what they've been feeding on. Let me just have a quick peer. Oh, I don't know, we might be a bit close to get that. Let's have a look, Brian. Too close?
Yeah, a bit close.
Too close, okay. I'm not going to move just yet. Oh no, there's some, a better one out there in the middle. And there is a different form of buffalo, not the one that's come out of a lion. That is just buffalo dung that's come out of a buffalo. And I'm sure if we started looking a bit carefully, we would find possibly some Inyala dung here, kudu dung. And, well, there we go. Well done, Brian. Brian, I would say that is Inyala dung from the size. Dung is quite an important thing for us out in the bush. I know it sounds absolutely crazy, but it is lets us know who's been around and how recently they were around. Now, the only fresh dung around us at the moment is the lion dung. And I suppose that makes sense since the lions are 10 feet from us. Now we are going to keep waiting here. I'm hoping those elephants I heard keep moving closer and closer. But while we do that, let's go see if Jamie's recovered from her injury.
I have indeed recovered from my injury. I've got one good eye and one somewhat blurry eye, but both of them are still functioning. I don't know what it was. I don't know if it was a stick to the eye or an insect to the eye. Whatever it was unrecognizable by the time it came out of my eye. But you'll be happy to hear that we are back up and running once again, and of course, resuming the search for the Queen of Juma, who might be a little blurry when I see her, but at least we'll get to see her. Now let's go and investigate. I'm hoping that the leopard that we're searching for, having made her way in this direction with the cubs first thing this morning, I'm hoping that she might decide, as it starts to get a little bit cooler, to go off in search of some water. So what we're going to go and do is check the nearest water holes around her and see whether or not she has popped up over there. Let's go and investigate. This is the joy, of course, of these live drives, is that sometimes things happen, sometimes the unexpected happens. Most of the time it's a pleasant unexpected thing, like a surprise encounter around a corner perhaps. Any sort of animal or bird or something like that, sometimes it's a stick or a bug to the eye. It's just par for the course. It is the first time VM has ever driven me in Jigger back to camp. Okay, let us go and investigate what's happening at the waterhole. This is one of Queen Karula's favorite spots. A couple of days ago, she was just 100 meters or so to the north of where I am now, in this very, very dense vegetation. This is where we saw her with her two gorgeous 8-month-old cubs, and of course where the wild dogs, speaking of nice unexpected surprises, where a pack of wild dogs came streaming in, grabbed a baby impala, and then dashed off and finished it, baby Nyala, sorry, and then dashed off again, leaving Karula to jump down, being the impressive mother that she is, and add the leftovers of the Inyala kill to her, basically her storage up in a Tambwoti tree. Just one of the many things that has happened while we've been filming these live safaris. Every moment is unexpected, and often a sighting that seems nice and relaxed is all of a sudden followed by something unexpected and incredibly interesting. Okay, this is one of her favorite spots, and I'm really hoping that she's decided to come through in this direction. This is also the first place I ever saw Queen Karula, this exact spot, when I first started working, doing these live safaris well over a year ago. But nope. Well, now it is not a spotted creature, but a stripey creature that has been frequenting the waterhole at Galagopan. Hello, Nyalas. There you go, talking about the Nyala kill that the wild dogs made. Here we have the surviving members of this particular herd, including one tiny little, couple of tiny little ones. These are definitely one of the most attractive of our antelope species. A deep reddish tan color with those amazing white stripes and dots combination. One of the viewers once told me a wonderful local legend about the reason why kudu, Nyala and bushbuck have these stripes and spots. Was when they were created, the creator realized that he'd made their legs too skinny to hold their weight up, and so he reached down from the sky and lifted them, and the white spots are where his hands touched the Nyala or the kudu, which is so perfect because it's almost, those white dots are almost like fingerprints. Such a beautiful local legend. Definitely one of my favorite, and one of the joys of working in the live safari. Thank you, Teresa, for that. Obviously, as you can see, that's something that has stuck with me for all the many months now. Every time I see an Nyala or a kudu or a bushbuck, that is the first thing that I think of. Let's see if we can get a better view of them. If we can't, we'll continue the search for the queen. Nope. I think the Nyala are giving us a good demonstration of why this is one of their favourite spots. They are next to invisible. One last view of the Nyala through the vegetation. They're hiding in trees. Let's go and find out what James is doing in one.
Now, of course, when you're in the bush, there are two things you must do in order to be very relaxed. The one is stare at the sky. The other is to get close to a tree, either by hugging it or sitting in it, as I am. Now, you might think to yourself, gosh, he looks comfortable. You'd be deeply wrong, and it's actually quite uncomfortable in a tree like this. But often we think of leopards, for example. They like to sit in trees. They do it for security and for vantage, normally not for comfort. That's because there's always something spiking you when you're sitting in a tree like this. That's not the main reason that we're here, of course. The main reason that we're here is to show you this rather odd leaf. Now, this leaf is normally green, but you can see it is, it's red. And it's red not because it's autumn, because it isn't autumn at all. It's not the fall. We're into summer. Now come over here, Egbert. Don't fall over. You're going to fall over that tree. Now, we're going to have a quick look at it under the microscope. And what you can tell from this is that it is packed full of tannins. Now, tannins, for those of you who are soft drinkers, that's the bitter taste that you get in black tea. Tannins are also, for those of you who are not for sort of harder drinkers, if you like, tannin is what makes bad red wine taste that kind of taste. Anyway, let's have a very quick look under the microscope.
Look at that. Isn't that lovely? And this is because it's a very new leaf, and new leaves need to defend themselves from predators, so they have this tannin in them, and that tannin protects them from being eaten. Tannin not great for the stomach, unless you have an upset stomach, in which case it's actually really good for your stomach. Now, we're going to head off for a short break. Don't go far, because of course we do have the lions and hopefully leopard. Now, internet viewers, hello again. Thank you for staying with us. I'm just going to give this a taste. Actually, it's not that bad. It doesn't taste too much different from what it tastes like normally. It's a Cambrium calinum, or variable bush willow, which many of you will have seen before. And that one, of course, has been totaled many times by elephants. I'm just looking at it now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It's got 10 stems. So it's been broken probably 10 times by elephants. Now, one other thing I wanted to show you here. I keep saying now, which I shouldn't say, because it becomes very boring when somebody keeps saying now. Have a look here. Before I try and look at it with the microscope, Handa, can you see it there? Look at that beautiful beetle. He's a copper-coloured beetle. He's probably related to the ladybirds, but we can't find him in any book. Now, let's see if we can't get his colours. He's a very recalcitrant fellow. He doesn't like to sit still. There he is. Look at that. How cool is that? See, he's trying to escape. Why wouldn't he? I'd try and escape too. So he all sorts of iridescent colours, much like a starling, I suppose. We'll try and follow him round. It's a little bit ridiculous. Okay, let's not try and do that any longer. Then we've got an adult version of the millipede. So there is the baby, and there is the adult. Same thing. And amazingly, that one that was cut in half there just crawled out of my hand, which makes me feel deeply uncomfortable. Anyway, this one is dead. It smells possibly as bad as the lion dung that Brent's been looking at. But what I want to quickly show you is the eyes, and they're called ocelli. From somewhere, there's the word. There we are. Now, the ocelli, everybody, you can't really see. You can see where the antenna joins the head. Just behind that, you might be able to see a few little lenses. There we go. Can you see those little lenses just underneath? There we are. There you can see them. And those are basically rudimentary eyes. And what they see, they've got photoreceptors, or photoreceptor cells, and those cells are able to pick up light and dark. They cannot tell the difference between, say, Panda and I, or you and the person sitting next to you and your cousin, but they are able to tell whether it's day or night. The rest of their sense is done by those feelers. We think that pick up moisture, perhaps tell which piece of rotting plant material is the best to eat. So that is the millipede, Myriapoda. Smelly Myriapoda. Right, Stefan Winterbord is knocking about the place. I'm not sure what he's digging up or unearthing now. Let's go and find out from him.
Welcome back. Yes, you're on the bushwalk with Stefan Winterbord. We've been knocking about in some, as James puts it, we've been knocking about in some bush that we haven't been into for a while. We walked quite far from camp this afternoon, first thing, around about 2 miles. We bumped into a buffalo, we bumped into a hippo. We then found a tuber that we made some water from. We found a lion's den, or at least we thought we found a lion's den, a good place for a lion's den, as far as I thought it. And then we saw a giraffe as well. So quite a few things that we've actually seen on our little amble through the bush here today. You catch me while I'm busy carving out a practice. This is basically a piece of square stemmed raisin, and as you can see, I've gotten a middle point there, and from it I am busy getting some slivers of bark off. Now, this is how you make a bow. Now, I did promise you that I'd be making a bow this week, but I realized that I actually don't know enough about bow making. So what I need to do is practice. And the best way you can practice is on thin little sticks like this. Now, when I got the stick, you couldn't bend it. Now I can bend it. Starting to bend a little bit. You've got to bend these things to find out where you take the material off. You take the material off on the side facing you, so that's how you'd draw it away from you. To do that, you've got to take the material off, but not so much that you change the characteristics of the boat. So it's just...
Watch out. We're back, we're back. Now, the other thing that's back, what were you doing back there, Kanda?
Table.
You know, you can't get good help these days, I tell you what. Stay there. Now, let's have a quick look at Ronald. No, in fact, it's not. We've got 30 seconds until we join our TV audience. I need to discipline this fellow with me. We'll bring the TV audience back with a picture of an elytra. In fact, I'm going to tell you about the elytra. There's an elytra. Now, I mentioned this earlier, everybody, and it's the top or modified hind wings of a beetle that gives it that sort of very hard shell. And this one is fused, so this beetle couldn't fly. Here we go. Welcome back on your live safari, everybody. If you've just joined us, it's wonderful to have you with us. We're broadcasting to you live from the middle of the African wild. We're here in South Africa, the world's most beautiful country, and I'm just going to show you something special before I carry on with that. Just over there, Eggsy, there's a bird. It's a gorgeous yellow-billed hornbill. My name is James Hendry. We're sitting in the tent here out on foot, Stefan Winterboer, with the lions, Brent Leo Smith, and then Jamie Patterson scouring the landscape for Karula the Queen. And that, everybody, is Harold the Hornbill. Isn't he gorgeous? Many of you, of course, will be familiar with the hornbill from The Lion King, Zazu, or Izazu, which means wise man in Zulu. And interestingly, we had the skull of a hornbill the other day, and it indicates that the brain is roughly the size of a groundnut. So how Zazu was so wise, I'm really not very sure. If you'd like to talk to us, hashtag Safari Live is the best way to get hold of us. It'd be lovely to have your comments or questions. We have a microscope in here. I'm afraid Ronald the Rover's gone on the blink, so we can't have a look at him. But we've got lots of entertaining things to show you out here in the African wild. Let's just observe what he's doing there. And what he's doing is, well, obviously he's having a scratch because he's itchy. Birds full of mites and things like that. But what he's also doing is preening. Now, birds have got to preen their feathers in much the same way that an aircraft must be constantly maintained every time it lands. So a bird must preen its flight feathers, otherwise it will plummet from the sky. And you know what happens then, Eggsy? It dies, yes. It gets a nasty headache. Right, as we try and get a little bit closer, Ronald's gone. Off he's gone. I suspect he's probably gone off towards where Stefan Winterboer is. Let's go and find out what Steph has found you.
Welcome back. Yes, and we are almost there with this mini bow that I'm busy designing or busy carving. Now, it takes a lot of practice out here to basically do these woodsman's things, and I thought to myself the other day that I was going to build myself a full-sized bow out here, but it proved to be a very difficult thing, to be quite honest with you, because to build a full-sized bow you've got to be able to do a bunch of things. You've got to be able to profile a piece of wood. This wood was unbendable when I first got it. Now it's starting to get some nice flex in it. I've got the middle point, as you see over there, the middle point, and I'm busy testing that flex as we... Now you can see that there's a little bit more on this side, or I can feel that there's a little bit more on this side than on the other. So just take off a sliver. That may have been a bit too much. I'm beginning to feel... Oh, there we go. So I don't want to break it. You want to be able to bend it but not break it. So just take a bit more out there. There we're starting to get some flex, and now what we need to start doing is designing the bowstring, which I made a little bit of bowstring yesterday. I'm going to see if I can do it and then tie it to this and then make a little arrow and shoot it for you and see if I can do that. So now we're busy doing a bow nock. That's where the string is going to sit. Let me do it on this side. All All right, I'm going to carry on with this, and then I'm also going to make some rope, which is going to take me a little bit of time, and then I'll show you my little dwarf or elf bow that we made. Hopefully I can get it to work. On that note, we're going to send you to Jamie with a crested barbet.
One of the things that we often mention on these live safaris is that it's not all about the big hairies and scaries, something that I think that Steph demonstrates exceptionally well. And here we have one of the most striking birds that we have on Juma Private Game Reserve. A beautiful crested barbet going about hopping around searching for any insects that he happens to collect. Or she. It's difficult to tell with these barbets, since both the males and the females look the same. Making some interesting facial expressions. I thought perhaps at first it might be panting because it was hot, but it's not. In fact, that looked almost like a yawn. Demonstrating that perfect avian head bob, as it looks first with one eye and then the other to pinpoint whatever insects happen to be run into its path. And then look at that enormously powerful bill. Speaking from experience, that beak is very, very strong. I once plucked a crested barbet out of our swimming pool at my parents' house in Johannesburg when I was still a child, and it ripped the skin almost what felt like at the time, although this is probably a childhood exaggeration, what felt like it went all the way to the bone at the time. You can see the beautiful combination of yellow and red and black. Lovely little birds. Now this particular crested barbet has been feeding in unison with a band of dwarf mongoose. There's one well spotted, Viam, scuttling about. These are one of my absolute favourite little creatures to see in the bush. Now I can't see any of them. They've all vanished. Wait, oh, here we go. I've spotted one. It's probably been keeping a close eye on me the whole time. Oh, bye-bye. Isn't that cute? Also searching for the same diet that the crested barbet is looking for, but they're more than happy to forage in their company of others, since it means extra eyes on the sky, or in the sky, and on the ground as well. Let's try and reposition for another view of the dwarf mongoose, because they are terribly attractive little creatures. The smallest predator on Juma Private Game Reserve. So small, they've all disappeared. Where did you go? I know that there was a whole group of them. There were about 8 or 9 here a moment ago. Ah, here's a second crested barbet, though, and a dwarf mongoose. And a spurfowl. We're doing exceptionally well. We've come upon a wonderful mixed species feeding party. There's the crested barbet, probably the partner of the one that we were just looking at. And generally, barbets can be quite confrontational birds to others of the same species that are not part of the same family group. But the males and females are monogamous, as is usually the case with birds. And this particular pair is probably in the process of building a nest somewhere in this general vicinity. It is nesting season for most of our birds. Spring is definitely in the air. And we've found a number of different birds that we'll be able to watch as they, hopefully watch, as they lay eggs and hatch this year's broods. Where's the dwarf mongoose gone? Ah, oh, chagra! Browned crown chagra. See, this is an amazing thing. One of the things we always encourage our new viewers to do is start up their bird lists. In other words, keep track of all of the different birds that they have seen on this fantastic live safari journey with us. We're always on the lookout for some of the more unusual birds, and a chagra hardly ever sits still long enough for any of us to see them. So that was fantastic. And there we go. James Richard says that he is looking forward to finding new birds to add to his bird list. I'm going to guess and say if James Richard has two, or is inching closer to 200 birds, I'm going to say the crested barbet and the brown crowned chagra are probably on them, on your bird list, as is this bird, I'm sure, the red-billed buffalo weaver. But James, we look forward to finding you some of the more unusual species, and perhaps since spring has sprung, oh, got something there, since spring has sprung, we will be seeing the return of the migratory species, things like the cuckoos and the kingfishers. Not sure, James, if you have all of the cuckoos on your list, or if perhaps there's one we can add. And who knows what other unusual birds we might get to add throughout the duration of the summer. That's half the fun of creating a bird list. It's like a treasure hunt that just goes on. And that, I think, is the attraction for so many people around the world, traveling to different places to try and tick off different species. It is, it really is like a treasure hunt. Rightio, let us go and investigate, see if we make one last ditch effort to find the Queen of Juma. In the meantime, let's head back across to Steph, who I'm sure has got something wonderful up his sleeve.
I'd hoped really to have this finished by the time I came to you for the end of the show, but it hasn't seemed to work out that way. So we are not going to finish this bow today. You're going to have to watch some more programs for me to finish this particular bow. But you can see that I'm starting to get some even flex on it now. And I can even take my time now to try and get proper decoration going on it as well. My little bow here. Have a look. I have carved in those, the nock for the string. I couldn't do this and unfortunately make you some rope as well in the time we have left. Time caught up with me today. So sorry about that, but we will get better at it, don't worry. Let's see if you can see the shape starting to come out. I'll take out the bits and pieces of bark here, make it look a bit prettier as well. Why am I doing this? I'm doing it because I need to practice the technique on something small so that I can do it on a bigger one. But, like we said, now's the time for me to say goodbye. I'm going to say goodbye for today. Thank you very, very, very much for joining me on the walk, and Jandre as well. Thank you for all your support. Thank you for all your questions. We'll catch you again tomorrow.
We are still sitting with the incredible Inkahumas. Unfortunately, they have barely moved a muscle. But, as I said, the most important arsenal in your weapon to see those incredible sightings is patience. It sounds like the elephants moved off slightly further to the east. But you never know, a buffalo might have wandered in here. Or Inyala could have started walking around the edge, although anything with a sense of smell wouldn't want to be sitting where we're sitting at the moment, because it is literally very smelly. Not only is the dung smell there now, there's also a lot of flatulence and we're directly downwind, but it's a small price to pay to sit next to Africa's dominant predator. Now you can see these lions all look very well fed. And Gorvin, a big welcome to Gorvin, who's a new viewer to Safari Live, would like to know, do we feed our lions? No, we don't, Gorvin. They have to hunt for themselves. We are part of an 8.5 million acre unfenced ecosystem known as the Greater Limpopo Transfrontier Park. And these animals are completely wild. They've never spent a day in captivity and they've never been fed. And we'd like to keep it that way. Wild animals should stay wild. I was hoping they might get up and start moving towards the waterhole, but it looks like not yet. So those of you who watch the Juma Dam Cam, I think there's a very good chance all the Inkahumas and the two Birmingham boys might meander through after dark to quench their thirst, so keep an eye out. At the moment, I think they probably are, maybe roll over once or twice, but they're not going to move. I mean, she almost looks like she's expired. And we can see the heavy panting of the full stomachs. And here we can see those very distinct suckle marks on one of the mothers. You can see how around her nipples it's slightly darker, and that's generally from being wet from the cubs suckling on it. Here we go. And it looks like also certain fly species enjoy a bit of lion milk. I myself will give it a skip. And we can see that beautiful pug in the pad. And
tomorrow morning we're going to be following those pug marks in the sand, hopefully being able to find.
And we're live, turn it down, we're about to wrap it all up, everybody. I think we've got roughly 47 seconds left. I'm going to show you one more flower. There it is there. We're going to look at it underneath the microscope very quickly. Woo! Let me quickly, come on, Henry, don't be an idiot. There we are. Oh, beautiful. Look at it now. Gorgeous. Beautiful. Okay, everybody, that's going to be it from us today. It'll be lovely to have you with us again tomorrow morning. Of course, a big thanks to Steph and Brent and Jamie and the whole of the Final Control. And of course to Ikhanda, who has been on camera with us today. Mostly, thank you to all of you for being with us today. It's been a joy to interact with you, chatting to you, and I hope you've enjoyed your live safari with us here in the Greater Kruger National Park. We'll see you tomorrow. Keep safe and happy wherever you are in the world. Bye-bye.